So I guess we'll get started for this session. I, Kristen Bennett of the USGS, will be a session chair, as well as Nandita Kumari from Stony Brook. Do you wanna take it away, Nandita?
Thank you so much, Kristen. Welcome back to LSSW Day 1, Session 3, and the session is Pathways and Bridges. I'm Nanda Kumari. I'm a PhD candidate at Stony Brook University with Professor Tim Glotch. This session will focus on how to engage a broader community and promote inclusive strategies within the community. The discussion session will focus on sharing strategies and resources related to engagement. And we'll be hearing from researchers and subject experts from several universities and organizations. And the discussion, like the final discussion of this session, will be like a continuation of what we had in the second session, that is sharing strategies and resources. So I'll hand it over to Kristen to talk about like how to use this session's Miroboard and logistics.
Yeah, so some logistics for those of you that just joined us this afternoon. The chat box is open for any comments, discussion. There is a separate Q&A box if you want to ask a speaker a question, and then the session chairs can relay it verbally during a Q&A session. You could also type those questions in the chat box. We'll find them. What else? So there's a Miro board that we've been using for each session. Parvathi has posted the one for this session in the chat. I will go over the two questions that we will be talking about at the end of this, so that if you don't want to go to Miro, you don't have to, and so that you can be thinking about these questions as this session goes on. So the first discussion question is, how could those of us involved in lunar science and exploration engage more meaningfully with wider communities? And then the second question is, what resources would enable you to build a more inclusive professional community? What support have you received or wished for from your colleagues? And Parvathi put those both in the chat, so you can refer to them there. We feel free to start responding to those questions in Miro. There's also a space for reflections for just any other thoughts that you have as these speakers are going through their talks. Trying to think, the code of conduct is linked in that Miro board. We're all still expected to adhere to those. And what else? Okay, so the time will show in Ricky's WebEx window. You can see that it is counting down. It changes colors when you get closer to your ending. So the session chairs will also kind of keep an eye on that if speakers are starting to run over. And I think that is it. So maybe we will get started 1 minute early to provide some buffer time. And so I'll hand it back to Nandita.
Thanks, Kristen. So our first talk is an invited talk from Dr. Catherine Gardner-Mandy. She's an assistant professor of aviation and space from Oklahoma State University and also PI of NASA Science Activation Program at OSU, named Native Earth, Native Sky. Dr. Cat, please take it away.
Right, Halik to Ikana, Hafami Hamona Yokpa. Hello, all my friends. A very happy new year to you all. And I'm very grateful today to be invited to talk to you all. And I'm coming to you all from Tulsa, Oklahoma, which is the land that is owned and operated by the Muskogee Nation. So today I'm very grateful to talk to you all about a workforce development model that I helped put together with some colleagues. Called the Braided River STEM Workforce Development Model. And I just want to point you to the bottom of my slide here where I have the citation for this. This is from an opinion article that we submitted to AGU's EOS, and it was published last April online, and it was published in print in September. So maybe some of you have seen it. I am going to put the into the chat the link to the AGU website for this. I'm going to show you all the model that we have within the paper, but I do recognize that the print is small. And so I'm worried that you may not see it very well on your screen here today. So if you want to click on it and look at the model enlarged on your own computer screen, that might help you out in some way. All right, before I get started, I do want to draw your attention to the beautiful image of a braided river that's here on my title slide. This is a braided river in New Zealand, and it's a really wonderful example of the morphology of a braided river. You'll note that it has a really wide channel. It has lots of smaller channels within it, water that looks to be of different widths in those channels, perhaps even going at different speeds and moving in different ways. There's also a lot of sandbars that have been created and carved out by the water. And you can see that it plays a really large role within the ecosystem that surrounds the braided river. All right, next slide, please. All right, so what I'd like to do today is really on the 10,000 foot view, I really would like for us to think about verbiage and what we're saying and the words that we're using. And so, time after time again, we hear about different workforce development models as a pipeline. We've all heard of a pipeline model and of course the leaky pipeline model. And so I went on a little random walk on Google and decided to look and see what kind of programs out there are really calling things still a pipeline. And so unfortunately I found a bunch. And these are some of the examples that I found. So as you can see, the pipeline models that are in existence still today are very linear. You have a very clear entrance into some sort of pipeline. You have a very clear exit into from that pipeline. And there's generally some sort of pre-described way to have your motion be within that pipeline. Sometimes, like the one on the lower left, you might have some twists and some turns. There could be some valves in between, but by and large, they all have that same output as an exit. The one on the lower right has some bends. You have some different little pieces that can come to it, but none of those different pieces are an exit. There's just the one exit. And finally, the one that actually was most alarming to me that I found on the upper right was a pipeline model that looks more like a pyramid, much that there is kind of a power dynamic going on. So there's definitely a structure where there's someone up high, and then you have a lot of many people who are working down low. So, as you can see, this pipeline model is very, very linear. It is not cyclical, and guess what? Life is not linear. All right, let's move to the next slide. So the question, of course, for this very centered discussion topic for these 2 days is, does this traditional pipeline model really effectively represent the workforce development that we would see in the lunar surface science community? I've already noticed some discussion in the chat about the type of community, the lunar surface science community, and how it is so decentralized. I think James used that word, was decentralized. And I think that's a very important point to make about this community, is that within lunar science, you're bringing in a lot of different types of populations. You have the university populations, you have different types of institutions, whether that be NASA or the NSF or museums. And then you have many, many industry partners. Likewise, you're going to have a lot of people from all different stages of life within that community. So to answer the question, does the traditional pipeline model really effectively represent the workforce development here? Not really. All right, let's move on to the next slide. All right, so this image here is the one I told you about that I linked in to the comments. If you want to make it a little bit larger on your screen, if you're having trouble seeing some of the words. This is our braided river model. And so what I do want to do right now is sort of unpack some of the things that are going on here. The image itself, by and large, is a three-dimensional model of a braided river where you can see many different water channels of varying widths and lengths moving at different speeds, and of channels, some sandbar channels of various lengths and widths as well. So if we look at the upper left, you can see all of the different water sources for this braided river model. In a traditional pipeline model, you would have one water inlet, but in a braided river, you have many different inlets. So here we might have, say, the main river. You might also have little tributary rivers. You might have some groundwater, and you might also have rain or something, some other kind of atmospheric water. And this is a really great representation for the different kinds of inputs that we have within our community. So K-12 education would be a really big one for students that move right from high school into an undergraduate degree that may fit in within lunar surface science. But then we also have some students who come from more informal experiences. You know, not all institutions have coursework that's consistent with what might be the case for what a student might do in terms of college work within the planetary sciences. So these informal STEM education experiences play a really huge role as well. Likewise, we have a lot of people coming in from different disciplines. Sometimes those are different academic disciplines, sometimes those are different industry partners, but they're all channeling in to that braided river system. All right, next we have the different kinds of training and institutions from an education standpoint that might be playing a role. Of course, we have a large channel for the four-year college university, which is true, but we also have a lot of input from community colleges as well. Likewise, there's some really small tributaries there, and I apologize for the small font, of teacher training, because we do have educators playing a really large role within this environment as well. All right, the channel then opens up, and you can see all of the different paths that water can take within the braided river. Some of these will take academic careers. Some of them go into postgraduate programs. Some of them take a more professional side and enter industry. The important thing here, though, is to note that every single piece of the braided river plays a big role into the braided river as a whole. There's no exit, there's no outlet. It's just one big system. And no matter if that water is slow, whether the water is fast, it is all carving out and being part of that braided river ecosystem. All right, another thing to point out here too, which is one of my favorites, honestly, is some of the, what would be considered impediments to flow within the braided river, but I like to just think as little neutral places to take a break. So water doesn't always flow down a braided river channel. It sometimes has, it brushes up against sandbars. There may be some sort of eddies in the flow. Things aren't always going to move linearly within a braided river system. So that happens. Likewise, you can see a little tiny beaver here in a beaver dam. There are sometimes outside things in the system that might actually stop the flow altogether. And in a braided river model, that's fine. It's a neutral activity. So having paternity leave, taking time to serve in the military, doing a fellowship outside of the country, none of those things would be seen as you leaving the workforce, leaving the and becoming a leak in the pipeline. They are just part of the neutral braided river system. All right, and finally, I want to show you that all of those streams, every piece of water that's part of the braided river system will eventually lead down to an inclusive STEM workforce, which is really the most important. All right, final slide, please. All right, so what I really would like to talk about, and we can move on into the discussion since I know my time is running out, how can we apply this braided river workforce development model into lunar surface science? So the first point that's really important is to really understand your location along the river, not only to self-reflect, but also to recognize who is around you in the river and who is not around you in the river, who should be there. Second, we really need to think as a community about redefining those nonlinear parts of the system, the more cyclical parts. So thinking about some of those times where we might take a break, thinking about those times where someone might be of age where they're not considered a young scientist, have that in terms of their placement along the river, maybe they took a break. We need to think about what defines success. We need to think about what defines an expert in the field as well. This can go into rethinking our education and public outreach programming. It's really important to do K-12 education, but we need to make sure we're doing that within other realms as well. Likewise, internships and mentorships need to just not be for the younger parts of the community. They need to extend all the way through. There need to be mentorship programs for early career and mid-career scientists as well. There's a cultural component here that's really important. Right here, I've given the example of the Maori Heyaha Feria, Braided River Approach to Indigenous Knowledge. This is the beautiful way in which Indigenous knowledge is actually braided in with Western science to have a whole picture of science. And it's very important that we think of those cultural components as well. And finally, as we had in our discussion already, we need to really think about some of those institutional changes that are necessary to have this verbiage, this braided river verbiage, be how we think about developing our workforce and not the linear pipeline model. All right, I think I went over time. I apologize for that. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks, Dr. Vandy. We'll move into the discussion session now, Q&A. We don't have any questions for now, but I want to mention that Parvati just said that she loves this analogy, and I agree with her. Like, this is really important to think about.
Yeah, and so we've got a few minutes for questions, so definitely put your questions in the chat and we'll relay them. I had one because this last slide that you just presented made me think about what we've been talking about throughout the day of what defines success, especially in lunar surface science. Sorry, maybe this is more of a comment than a question, but I'm loving everything you're saying. I in that context of what defines success and within the braided river model, there's been a lot of comments from people wishing that, you know, you could take breaks and you can support your mental health and like not work 80-hour weeks and things like that. And this really defines that is everything that you do is worthy and worth it and valuable. And it also leaves space for if someone does find those, you know, long weeks to be fulfilling and what they want to do in life, it also says that what they're doing is valuable. And so I just wondered if you could expand on that thought of success and that a little bit more.
Sure. Yeah, that resonates with me a lot as well, because in a pipeline model, unless you make it to the end of the pipeline, you're not considered successful. You know, you're a leak that's evaporated and wow, that doesn't feel very good. So I love this model because no matter where that water enters and no matter where that water exits, maybe it does exit the system, it still made a huge contribution to carving out that ecosystem. So I think the really important thing actually is this last bullet, which is demanding institutional change and recognizing that the way in which this pipeline model is really geared toward is very Westernized. And when we take a global holistic look at the way science is accomplished, that doesn't fit. It doesn't fit at all. And so we need to really keep pushing back on that, the more inclusive, open way that really does braid, or sometimes I use the word interweaves, our cultural knowledge with the Westernized science knowledge.
I hear from Parvati has a question. Do you know where the pipeline model came from? Like, why is it so pervasive?
Parvati, I have no idea. I remember hearing about pipeline when I was in high school. I mean, they even would have programs that would be called, you know, the college pipeline. So that's a really great question. I think it's just a very, you know, decades old ingrained idea. And the more we push back on that and talk about other ideas, the more we can change that ingrained idea.
And I see that Richard has a question. Do you want to say it out loud? Are you unmuted?
Are you talking to me?
Yeah, do you?
Yes. I wanted, Kat, thank you so much for your good work here. This is great. What I did outreach for 15 years at JPL. And one of the issues was when we succeeded in bringing someone, say, from the Navajo Nation as a as an engineer at JPL, there would be inevitably at times, maybe five or six years later, when that person would want to return to their community. NASA would view that as a failure and would feel that they had invested in somebody and then lost them, rather than turn it around and say, this is the best outreach possible. And it was just like, how can we change that view. And this braided river model is, you know, so succinct and great. And I think in practice, those of us who had these insights then were doing something like this. I also wanted to say, I'd like to see this extended, you know, in the high school, middle school, elementary school, because they don't get that message. They're still being told about pipeline stuff. So anyway, those are my thoughts that I wanted to offer.
Yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate that. And your comment about place is very significant to me. That's yet another part of the institutional change that really needs to happen, is a overwhelming understanding that with Native populations, you're going to stay within your place. That's very, very important. You're not going to do research usually that's going to be outside of what you have that place-based context for. So institutions really need to understand that.
Thanks so much. Well, I think there's more questions in the chat, but we're going to move on. Maybe we can get to it in the discussion at the end of the session. So thank you again. Okay, the next speaker is Dr. Sarah Torres, and she is an educator professional development collaborative specialist at NASA Ames. The EPDC program aims to serve STEM educators and their students across the country. And the talk is titled Exploring the How of Contributing to Equity, Inclusion, Diversity in the Lunar and Planetary Community. Go ahead.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Christina, for that introduction. I'm glad to be here, and just the conversations are just very thought-provoking as we continue on this afternoon. So if we could go to the next slide, please. So I'd like to begin with a gracious space. So this is work done by Patricia Hughes for the Center for Ethical Leadership. There's four elements of gracious space that I'd like to introduce to help us navigate throughout the next 15 minutes or so that I'm gonna be speaking to you. One is the spirit, which is bringing the elements as welcoming and compassion and curiosity, which I'm already experiencing through the sessions. The other is the setting. So I know that especially going to virtual, it gets a little bit difficult to be able to connect with people. But even virtually, I believe that we can do this and connect with each other, and to be able to support our ability to feel productive and healthy and connected to our work. The others invite the stranger, and sometimes this could even include, well, this usually includes someone who's not typically involved in the conversation. But sometimes that person can be ourselves. Especially if we're moving into areas that we are not familiar with. And the other is learning in public, which is the second systems approach, which is really to apply deep listening and learning to the diversity that has gathered into gracious space. Next slide, please. So I'm going to share my story with you. I grew up in Texas. I grew up about 60 miles southwest of San Antonio in a little bitty small town called Sabinal. It has one traffic light and a fast food restaurant, because you would consider a fast food restaurant. But I grew up with surrounded by family. My grandparents spent a lot of time with grandparents and aunts and uncles. I have two younger brothers, and we spent a lot of time outside. My grandparents would work in field work, so we did a lot of planting outside, and so a lot of our time was outside. But I grew up in a small town where we had two classrooms. There were two classrooms to every grade level. There was a smart class, and then there was the other class. And up until about third grade, I was happy going to school. Got to have a core group of friends that I would see every year. But however, by the time I was in third grade, which is a photograph you see on that slide, I began to realize that there were two classes. And So every year I would hope that I would be smart enough to go into the smart class, but somehow was never moved over there. And so it wasn't until about sixth grade that my principal took both classes out to garden, to actually do a plant journal. So we'd collect plants, and it was the first time that we all got together. Okay, go ahead and go to the next slide, please. So I want to talk about the power invitation. Next slide, please. As I mentioned, I grew up in a very small town. My focus was not on academics. I left high school with a lot of great memories that included athletics, but didn't really was not prepared with study tactics and so went to a junior college, was there for about a year and a half, had my ups and downs, and finally got my grades high enough to be able to transfer to a university, went to UTSA and got my four-year degree, and then went straight to work and was in the classroom for 14 years teaching public school. And then I received an invitation to enter a grad program. And I went ahead and started that graduate program. And after the first summer session, my mentor and friend and professor actually pulled me aside and said, hey, if the opportunity presents itself, I'd like for you to go all the way. And I said, oh, sure, I'm going to finish this program. And he was like, no, I'm not talking about this program. Yes, you will finish, but I'm talking about your PhD. So that was the first time that anyone had invited me, other than my master's program, invited me and thought I was smart enough to go into higher ed or go into a program like the PhD. So started that that road and just completed my PhD in December of 2020. One actually, just this last December. So, so the power invitation is very needed. A lot of times, students don't realize that they have the ability to enter these circles. So, so I want to encourage everyone to be able to use that. Okay, next slide, please. So I worked as a certified public school teacher in San Marcos for 14 or 16 years, actually. And during the work that right before I went on to PhD and went into higher ed, some of the work that we did or do now is we discuss with teachers some of the we discuss with teachers culturally relevant teaching. So we discuss ways that we as a STEM community can expand the playing field to fully incorporate individuals or groups that have been traditionally underserved or underrepresented in STEM fields. A lot of times we don't realize how privileged we are and how we have the ability to change the trajectory of people's lives. So the first thing is to bring awareness. So when we work with teachers, we bring awareness of this. Next slide, please. So culturally relevant teaching, I believe you have some sessions tomorrow that include this. You know, there's been two trailblazing scholars in the area of culturally relevance in the classroom. One is Gloria Latson-Billings, who coined the concept of culturally relevant pedagogy, and Geneva Gay, who coined culturally responsive teaching. A lot of times, especially when I was in the classroom, I heard a lot of teachers that would say, well, I see my students all the same way and I treat them all the same way. But it's really critically important that teachers recognize or educators recognize individuality of each student as cultural beings. That's what Pollock teaches us. And we just want to make sure that we take all of that into account. So very quickly, next slide, we're going to talk a little bit about culture. You know, when you see the word culture, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Or, you know, you can type your chat in your thoughts in the poll, but we can go on because I know that we're limited on time, so we can go on to the next slide. But I know that some people are going to be already chatting or putting some thoughts in the chat box. So one of the things that we like to think talk about, and I'm using an image that I borrowed from my colleague, this is what we consider like a cultural iceberg. So this is a visual representation of really the dynamic and complex nature of culture. So culture can be viewed in two different parts. Like the iceberg analogy, there are two distinct elements of culture. There's a surface culture where we normally, you know, respond to, which is the food, the flags, you know, friends, those kinds of things, all the language, all of those things. But there's also a deep culture, which is not readily seen or is mostly out of sight. And those are the things that include something like communication styles and the rules or the attitudes towards our elders, that kind of thing. So next slide, please. So we define culture as knowledge, skills, attitudes, beliefs, values, and emotions that we as human beings have added to our biological base. So culture is a social phenomenon. It is what we as a society or people share, and which enables us to live as a society in order for humanity to survive. So it's necessary that we learn our culture. So we need to, you know, such as it's, you know, it's critical for us as educators or to view our students as cultural beings and with, you know, distinct worldviews, with distinct learning styles. And it's really our job to understand and leverage the unique cultural characteristics that they bring to the classroom. Next slide, please. So then we go into cultural competence. So cultural competence is about building understanding between people and working towards equity or equality and opportunity through respect and understanding of different cultural perspectives and the funds of knowledge, which is what they're bringing from their homes. And we consider how to incorporate these understandings when engaging the diverse audiences in order to foster a supportive and respectful learning environment. So next slide, please. So when we talk to teachers, to educators, we talk about some tools, strategies, and resources that can help us foster this STEM excellence in our classroom, schools, and communities. So we're gonna go through very quickly and just talk about the first thing, which is investing in meaningful relationships, you know, investing, nurturing, cultivating, and sustaining positive, respectful relationships with youth are really the foundational to the teaching and learning processes in the classroom. Next slide. Some of the things that we can do is to assume good intentions and approach all families or guardians as partners who want the best for their children. You can invite their families or guardians to share, especially in the younger grades, and really to recognize and respect different family structures. You can go ahead and go to the next slide. And then you can view linguistic, cultural, and family diversity as strengths. Go ahead and move on to the next slide. So we like to really encourage incorporating family and community knowledge, and that can greatly enhance student learning. So students possess tremendous experiential wisdom on issues related to identity, culture, history, justices and injustices. So we really build that community of family members, friends, neighbors, and community members that frequently have stories to share and usually happily talk to students about their lives and their perspectives. Next slide, please. So we always encourage for the creating that inclusive learning environment, generating a safe space where individuals are valued, curiosity is nurtured, and failure is part of the learning process. And we just have a few more slides to go here. We always make the possibilities visible. So it's important for educators to provide that visual representation of diverse individuals who have had an impact in the world of NASA and who reflect on the lived realities of students in our classrooms. So we encourage educators to talk to their students about these people like Katherine Johnson and Jose Hernandez. Next slide, please. We also utilize culturally relevant, responsive, and sustaining resources that we have at NASA. And it's not just about having things translated. It's actually using bilingual texts and indigenous-oriented curricula that can be powerful tools really to engage and inspire students in our classrooms that will connect with those resources more than our traditional textbooks and materials. Okay, next slide. And we also like to leverage those teachable moments, whether it's a perseverance landing or anything that's going on, whether it's experiences on the ISS. We like to inspire, encourage them to be trailblazers and to inspire them to follow their dreams. Next slide, please. And I think the last slide is just additional resources if anyone would like to look those up. Those are some links. And then the next slide, please, is just a reflection question. And it's like, who can we identify as potential contributors to help more inclusive and diverse spaces? It takes a community. So we want to make sure that, again, that we help others to begin that that process of maybe even sometimes getting out of our comfort zone and digging deeper. So I believe that's the last slide.
Thank you. Yeah, I think maybe time for one question. And if there are other questions, we can put them in, folks can put them in the chat. I was wondering, I really enjoyed your talk. Thank you. You mentioned the surface culture versus deep culture and how, that can be varied. How do you have any advice for how to start recognizing how the culture that you may have maybe different than students that are coming into your classrooms or into internship programs, and how do you start becoming like providing a more inclusive space by thinking about the different cultures?
Sure. So one of the things that that I like to, when we talk to educators, is one of the things I've always done is to really make sure that students are valued, so that the contributions that they're coming with, whatever, their funds of knowledge or whatever they're bringing with them, that it's valued and that it's projected as being important. So many times, one of the things that I liked to do whenever I was an educator in my classroom is we would really when we begin to build our community, our students and other people around us, is to talk about how there's no right or wrong answer at NASA. The crazier the better, especially at places like NASA. So it's just about how we approach whatever the topics, and another thing is really for me personally, when I started talking or understanding more about culturally relevant teaching, it was really about not being afraid to ask questions. Right, a lot of times we wonder or we think, I wonder if that's going to be offensive, or I wonder if I can ask this question. But most of the time, it's about asking questions and then showing interest and having that conversation with people, and valuing their ideas for sure.
Great, thank you so much. And if there are any other, there might be other questions in the chat. We can try to get to them in the later discussion time. The next two talks are going to be back to back. Then there'll be a joint Q&A. Nandita, do you want to introduce them?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Kristen. So our next talk is by Dr. Caitlin Ahearns and Dr. Cassandra Runyon. Dr. Caitlin Ahearns is a NASA postdoc fellow at Goddard Space Flight Center and also a Diviner Science team member, might I add, a great human being. Dr. Cassandra is associate professor at College of Charleston. Thanks, both of you, for joining us. And please take it away.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Great. Awesome. All right. So thank you so much for allowing me to talk about the blind and deaf communities. It's an interesting community to work with, for sure. And while there may be some outreach resources somewhat available, it's never enough. And at that point, you can say that with almost any community at this point. There's always never enough. But there needs to be more steps in the right direction. For the time being, it seems like resources have pretty much stopped altogether for the blind and deaf communities. So we're going to kind of bring that more into view and maybe some possible next steps on how we can move forward for these communities. Next slide, please. So bear with me then, we're going to actually talk about perseverance for a little bit here. So I'm sure many of us have actually experienced that wonderful live stream of the perseverance landing and going through the 7 minutes of terror with the team, and we get to see the excitement. We can feel the energy and the electricity, even just virtually. And next slide, please. So through the live stream, NASA was able to even show the capsule, at what angle and at what point was it going through its EDL sequence. We can see Jezero Crater starting to build up in its point of view, and it was just so exciting. Next slide, please. So how was this event viewed by the deaf and blind communities? So specifically, I interviewed it with Mr. Saylor, who is a blind YouTuber and game designer consultant. So he allowed me to interview him as far as, and he's a wonderful space nerd too. So he says hello to everybody. So how did he specifically perceive the Perseverance event? Next slide, please. So he took it as more of an interesting stance. He enjoyed it. He enjoyed the commentary that was being felt around. He definitely knew when the 7 minutes of terror were, because you can almost hear the inflections of folks through the commentary of the live stream. Next slide, please. But it wasn't enough. There were still a lot of jargon to be had. There wasn't enough to feel the experience. What he would have liked to have had to really value the Perseverance landing and just the whole experience in general is, can we have more of a podcast-like, almost radio drama from back in the 50s and 60s? Can we have that kind of commentary instead? In which case, that would be considered a descriptive audio. Next slide, please. So if you were to just simply Google NASA blind deaf resources, next slide, please, you would usually get a lot of news articles, some as late as May 2021, where there was this beautiful group of students signing with NASA and ESA astronauts in orbit. That was great. The other ones back in 2004 and then 2013, there's tactile tours, and then there's, but it's mostly just news articles. So where's the actual resources? Next slide, please. So we have CORE, which is essentially the central operation of resources for educators. So at that point, you would have this whole dedicated page specifically for closed caption products. You would have tactile products involved with this too. You would have different kinds of descriptive audio. You would have all of these different kinds of resources. What can be better? Next slide, please. Yeah, guess what? It doesn't exist anymore. So due to loss of funding, unfortunately, this entire page no longer exists. Therefore, all of those resources are now scattered or not well archived. Next slide, please. So the value of CORE is still very much on the website, but a central hub for these kinds of resources, unfortunately, are no longer there. And this needs to be a thing again. Next slide, please. So when I mean scattered, I mean you can very easily still go to NASA Educational Resources. This is just an example here. You can have video, you can have multimedia, posters, mobile apps. Mobile apps are getting a little bit better, specifically for screen readers. So screen reading is becoming more of a citizen science involvement project, not necessarily under NASA, but just in general. And that's also a good idea to have at a later time. But because all these resources are scattered, they're not necessarily conducive for the blind and deaf communities, specifically with posters. If you were to have a poster that had Braille on it, there's pros and cons. Pros is that it's Braille. You have a whole nother language and alphabet involved for the blind communities. The con of that is that Braille isn't often read anymore, unfortunately. Screen readers are now becoming more of a forefront for the blind community. So Braille is unfortunately becoming a lesser language. Next slide, please. So more interviews that I've had, specifically I work with rural educators, and so take that a step further, rural deaf and blind educators. So Braille books, on what I just said about Braille being not a very good language to even have in the first place, but also they are super expensive and can be very bulky as well. Even printing them can be quite expensive. Most Braille books, you would have to be loaned out to the educators, so you wouldn't even be able to keep them. You would have to send them back. So there's time involved, and then obviously there's funding involved. But can you just make your own? Braille printing is also very expensive. Now, what if we just did this completely virtual? Okay, that's a possibility as well, but captioning needs to be better in that regard. 3D printing is also a capability as well, but again, with rural educators, they may not have the funds for a printer. But say they have a printer. Is there a central hub for such 3D printing models, say of like certain lunar craters? Not necessarily. They'd have to go hunt for them. And they may not even have the training or even have the time for training to use a 3D printer. Next slide, please. So what exists today? There are very minimal resources involved. There's the Survey Center for Lunar and Asteroid Surface Science tactile books, which are fantastic. That's by my colleague Cass. But unfortunately, it's still a very slow process because you need the resources and the time to actually make those books. SciViz is a fantastic resource for middle school age children. It's space camp for the visually impaired. Next slide, please. So some examples of some tactile books I actually have on hand. Like the Guide to the Solar System. So all of it is in Braille, but you can feel like the different planets and whatnot. Next slide, please. The issue with the tactile guides, though, is that they just purely tell you the name and what it is. You know, here's the planets, and that's it. So not a lot of actual information going on here. Next slide, please. So there are some evolving projects going on, mainly through the heliophysics division, specifically with Punch. So Punch is definitely using more tactile representations of solar storms. There's also the Eclipse Soundscape Citizen Science for the blind communities as well. So that's a good step in the right direction as to involving these communities more with science and data products. But in terms of planetary science, we are very much lacking. Next slide, please.
A
I
little
did.
over time, if you
Oh,
can
sorry.
wrap up.
Yeah,
That's
we'll
not
let
an
this be
issue.
my last slide real quick then. So I did a quick experiment with the International Observe the Moon Night, and working with different blind and deaf educators to make this YouTube video. YouTube is really accessible. I had a descriptive transcript. There was hardly any jargon with it. It was fully captioned. You can include transcripts in with YouTube videos. And so having visual images, having these captions. So I worked with the communities to make this YouTube video. And what I propose then to the lunar community is, can we make these videos for the Artemis missions and for other lunar missions like Viper and Lunar Trailblazer? And have these freely accessible, and then somehow have these all in a central hub for these communities. Thank you.
Thanks,
Thanks, Caitlin.
thanks. Sorry. Thanks, Caitlin. So we'll move on to our last talk for now, and then we'll get back to it in discussion. So our final talk of the session is an invited talk from Dr. Alexandra Matyala-Novak and team. Dr. Novak is a planetary scientist at APL, El Aramani RF science team member, and has also served as education and public outreach lead for several NASA missions and survey teams. So please take it away, Dr. Novak.
Thank you so much. I'm really happy. You can hear me, right?
Yes.
Okay, I'm so happy to be here today. The talks that I've been hearing have just been great, and the discussion also equally great. So thanks everyone for offering your perspectives. I'm here today to talk about planetary reach. Reach stands for resources and content heroes, preparing for more inclusive engagement. Next slide, please. So Planetary Reach is one of 29 SMD science activation teams. So science activation teams, their role is to connect the research that scientists in the Science Mission Directorate are doing, funded by NASA's SMD work, at connecting that research with broader audiences. And so we're one of 29 teams. And I think, you know, our team is definitely one we're coming to address a specific problem of the lack of representation in our community. So next slide, please. So this lack of representation is really an ongoing problem. And did it switch yet on your side? It hasn't switched for me. Okay, there it is. And this is you know, something that we've been dealing with for a while. And also Planetary Reach, another goal of Planetary Reach is to connect subject matter experts or SMEs with audiences. And that's one of the challenges that some of the science activation teams has been having for the last few years that those teams have been funded, is they're having a hard time getting those subject matter experts to really be a part of their programs persistently and being able to have them engage with audiences regularly. And so our team is trying to fill in some of those gaps that are there. And in addition to that, there's also been an identifiable problem of that there still needs to be more outreach to underrepresented audiences and diverse learnities in their communities. So that's another thing that we're trying to do. Next slide, please. All right, so the drive for what we're doing came out of some surveys and papers about our workforce recently. And part of it, again, goes back to needing to integrate more SMEs with the science activation teams. And also, again, trying to address the issue of the major underrepresentation of Black and Latinx communities, particularly in the planetary science. So there has been some growth in these communities, in the planetary science community, but it's still very low double digits. And so there's still definitely a big problem with underrepresentation there. Next slide, please. So in order to have, you know, a team that can talk about representation, we need to be a team that is representative. So we do have a really diverse team. I think that's one of the strengths of our project, is that we have a really diverse team. We believe very much that representation matters. I've heard a few discussions today talking about the need to put more diverse scientists in front of diverse audiences, so that way there's relatability there. The audiences can see themselves in the scientists and say, okay, I can do that too. I can be a part of the planetary community as well, because I see someone that looks like me or that has my same background and experiences is there in the planetary science community, so I can be there as well. Next slide, please. We also have a lot of educators on our team, and I'm sure some of these names are familiar to many of you. I have a lot of experience and perspective from the education community with the team of educators that we have. Next slide. And then, of course, we have evaluators, because we always want to be looking inward and making sure that the things that we're doing are actually achieving the goals that we set out for. So we have a couple of evaluators as well who provide us really good information. And we've already done several surveys and evaluations of the communities that we want to reach, not just the audiences, but also the subject matter experts and informal educators as well, who we will be employing to reach these diverse audiences. Next slide, please. So again, just going back, what is REACH? It's a replicable model for preparing planetary SMEs for engaging audiences in planetary science. And you can go to the next slide. When we talk about content heroes, that's the CH in the acronym, we're really talking about all of you. And so we're really here to connect you all specifically with these audiences and give the training that is needed to help prepare subject matter experts to engage with diverse audiences. Next slide, please. I think, is there, okay, there we go. So when we build a capacity of planetary subject matter experts, we're focused specifically on Blatt and Lekki's audiences, and we're doing that by trying to engage them directly with Black and Latinx subject matter experts. But this is a program that is available for everybody. So although our focus is the underrepresentation problem, we're also very aware that diversity means not just people from certain cultural backgrounds or certain ethnic backgrounds. Diversity can mean a lot of different things. So by addressing the sort of best practices for how to reach diverse audiences, that will actually benefit everybody. And all people will feel more welcome in our community, not just the people that we really see are underrepresented, but all people will feel welcome. Next slide, please. So I spoke earlier about we had evaluators who had also already done some surveying, and some from that we did find some needs. We were able to identify some needs already. The biggest one, barrier, is really about where we're doing our science education and outreach. We have a traditionally we've done them in our institutions or at science centers or at planetariums, and we're starting to see more that we really need to reach out to the community and go into these spaces in these different spaces where these underrepresented audiences are to reach them. So these are some of the things, the questions that we asked in these needs assessment. And one of the things that came out of it was the location piece of it. The next, next slide, please. All right, so yeah, this is basically, again, I think I got a little bit ahead of myself about the one thing, one of the biggest barriers that we identified was the location where we're holding our outreach activities and events. And so what we're doing right now is we're actually looking for more culturally responsive places to hold our outreach events. So that might mean doing them at art museums or at history museums. It might not necessarily be in the traditional spaces of where we think to talk about our science. We have to think of non-traditional spaces now because we're trying to be more broad and more diverse. So next slide, please. And this is my last slide. This is just to show some of the places that we're working in right now. One of our main activities is to do workshops, and we're training both SMEs to reach diverse audiences, but we're also working with educators, informal educators as well, because they can also give us some advice about how they reach their audiences as well. So it's sort of a relationship that goes back and forth between scientists and educators, but the main drive is to show that we do have scientists of color in our community, and we have ways to engage those scientists with more diverse audiences. And that's it. That was my last slide. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Novak.
I did forget. I wanted to let you all know there's another science activation team that is coming up with grants, because I know one of the barriers of SMEs being involved, I'm just put the link in the chat, is a lack of resources. Like our time is important, right? We actually need a budget to charge our hours for some of this work that we're going to do. So there is one science activation team that is giving out seed grants of $5,000 to $20,000 for scientists to work with other science activation teams. And we're one of those science activation teams. So, and there's many, many more as well that you can work with. But the important thing is here is that NASA is starting to put money into giving scientists a budget to be able to participate in these activities. Yes, these particular speed budget, if you look at the link, it'll like give you more information, but it's seed grants to scientists and engineers. Engineers too, sorry. And that's it.
We're running a little behind schedule, so there's a Q&A session right now that's both for both of the speakers that just happened. Maybe we'll do one question each so we can move to the discussion section. Nandita, I'll pick one for Caitlin because I saw it up there. And do it. Where did it go? Oh, okay. So the question was from Parvathy. And so for Caitlin, do you know what kind of funding lines are available for making spacecraft data more accessible to the deaf and blind community? And then maybe kind of a follow-on question is what kind of funding lines were you using to create the YouTube video that you made for International Observe the Moon Night?
You're currently muted.
Thank you. All right. So great question. Thank you. By all means, if you can give me more answers, that would be great. I saw on one of the sticky notes that PDART, I'm kind of questioning that a little bit because PDART usually isn't for educational purposes, but maybe it is. I'll have to ask the program officer for that. As far as the YouTube video goes, completely voluntary. All of my work has been completely voluntary for this.
Well, we thank you for your service and hopefully we can get you funding soon. Yeah, Nandita, do you have any other questions you want to ask?
I am not very sure who this question was meant for. This is a question by Edith Weeks. They ask, do you have an explanation as to why the lack of engagement has been defined as a problem? Can you explain, and why does representation matter?
That's probably for me. So can you repeat the first one? Sorry.
Do you have an explanation as to why the lack of engagement has been defined as a problem?
I'm not sure I understand that question. I mean, lack of engagement is a problem, right? So we need to do a better job engaging underrepresented communities. This is sort of well documented. I don't think that answers the question, but I'm not sure I really understand where the question's coming from. So, and then representation matters. Why is it defined as a problem? Well, does anybody want to help me out here? Why would lack of engagement be a problem?
I was going to use this as a segue into the first discussion question we have, which is talking about how to engage more meaningfully with groups. And so maybe this can, because I think maybe the question was getting at, why do we need to work harder to engage people? And I think that the conversation today has shown that, you know, maybe there are certain people who we want in this field that aren't here. And so we need to work harder to engage more people and make sure that there's space and there are lack of barriers and things like that. And engagement is one part of it.
Yes.
And so I'm going to segue. And if the speakers want to stick around and answer these discussion questions verbally, that would be great. Otherwise, up to you. And so, Ricky, if I could share my screen at some point, that would be great. And I'm going to share the Miro board. And okay, we've got like 15 minutes left, so we'll try to do these quickly. Sharing screen. Let's do this. Okay, so if you haven't been here today, this is the Miro board. We've got different discussion questions. You can write your thoughts on a sticky or raise your hand. I cannot see the participant list anymore, but maybe Nandita can be in charge of seeing if anyone's raised their hand. Put stars on ones that you like. And I'm gonna go ahead and ask this question that hasn't gotten a ton of response. And so I think maybe we need to explain what we mean by this. How could those of us involved in lunar science and exploration engage more meaningfully with wider communities? And I had a conversation with Parvathy about this, and I think she mentioned that she talked to Alexandra about this a little bit. Just in terms of, it's such a privilege to be here talking about space. It's really, it doesn't, sometimes it's hard to, connect what we're doing meaningfully with like humanity and like how to make life better for people on Earth. I'm not explaining this very well, but if Parvathy wants to jump in, or if any of our speakers kind of see the direction that I'm going and want to jump in, feel free to interrupt. But it's sometimes people don't engage with planetary science because they want to see a more direct impact on their communities, on their lives. And planetary science is very like forward-looking and just kind of like exciting as opposed to practical, if that makes any sense. If anyone else wants to jump in, go ahead.
Yeah, I'll jump in because I think your answer is pretty much on. I mean, what I've experienced is that there are so many problems that underrepresented communities are dealing with right now that are in their face all the time. And they feel like, with that always in the front of their mind, it's hard to focus on stuff that, like you said, is so forward-looking. But there was a presentation earlier about connecting science to cultural experiences. And I think that's the secret. I think we as scientists need to just be better about communicating about what we do, how it helps everybody, how it helps society. It's not just about these, meeting these science requirements that we get so focused on or answering these specific questions. It's a broader thing about helping society. And also, the other thing I'll just mention really quickly is that sometimes speaking about your own barriers and how you overcame those barriers in your story about yourself, how you became a scientist, that can be a way to connect with people too. So it doesn't just have to be a cultural or ethnic connection. It could also just be a connection about struggle and how you got through that. And that can also be really inspiring people because everybody struggles. So when you hear how somebody else overcame it, it can help you too.
Thank you so much for that. If anyone else wants to speak to that, any of the speakers or Parvathy or anyone like that.
I kind of have like a general question because this is something that has been on my mind, which can be answered by Sarah, Doris, and other speakers, I think. So one thing that came up was like the iceberg culture, right? Where we see the tip, but we don't see a lot of other stuff that lies beyond. I had a recent conversation with another person of color who's a postdoc, and they were talking about how they don't want to discuss their experiences in the grants they write because, like, for some reason, I also speak this as a person of color. We want to talk about our experiences, but we do not want to be pitied for it, which we somehow get the vibe of. So we did talk about it among ourselves, and I could relate to that, but I don't think they will ever talk about it with their advisor or the current mentor. So how do we break that barrier where like we feel confident enough to talk about it to like other people instead of like just between us, you know?
I can
If
start
I can speak to
answering.
that,
Go
okay, go
ahead.
ahead. Okay, well, I was gonna say I don't have my camera on just because I'm trying to save on bandwidth. I'm out in the middle of in a rural area, so I get satellite Wi-Fi, so mine's very slow. But so I have my camera off, so hopefully you can hear me. But it does take a sort of vulnerability, right, to share. If I think if I would have had more time, I would have been able to share more about my academic struggle going through and through school. When you think about it, when you start thinking about reaching students, I've had this conversation with, I think I went to a conference, the ACES conference, if anyone's familiar with that one. That's the American Indian I think it's called Science and Engineering Society, has like a conference for Native Americans. And I had a graduate student from MIT who came up to me and posed that very question: is how do you reach students on the reservation when most of them don't have, electricity or to power their homes or running water in their homes? And it is a conversation. I mean, it wasn't something that I could answer right then and there, but I do know something. I do know that kids get excited, right, with science. And the truth of the fact, or the truth of the matter is that our demographics are changing. Not just, I'm speaking specifically to Texas, but not just Texas, across the United States, our demographics are changing. The faces of scientists that we see today are not the same faces we're going to see in the very new in the near future. I mean, they're starting to change. So, I believe it's like something like 80%, I think, are now students of color. I believe are now the minority is now the majority, right? So definitely, what we consider as your model student, your straight A, strong in science and STEM or whatever student, is not always going to look like that as we begin to have this demographic shift, because not everyone's going to have straight A's and be the model student yet. To me, it's like I struggled. My own struggle was being on academic probation in at a junior college, before I got my act together. I didn't have the study skills or the practice of being able to have long-term academic study goals. So I think with a lot of just vulnerability and being able to open up and having these conversations is a good start, to be able to speak to students who maybe didn't get that strong start in academics, and seeing more of the whole person and not just on that side of it.
Thanks,
Thank you.
Sarah. I think we might want to transition to the next discussion question. I'll note that the sticky note that's gotten the most stars so far has been this comment about I would really like to see us engage with communities on an equal footing rather than acting as though we're doing them a favor. And so I think that's really important to remember going forward. It's not like we're going out and bestowing this wonderful thing upon people. It's like we really want this to be an equal partnership moving forward, and making sure that's in the front of our minds as we're doing these outreach things. So thank you for that conversation. I'm going to move to the last question. I'll get there. With just a couple minutes, what resources would enable you to build a more inclusive professional community? What support have you received or wished for from your colleagues? I know a big theme today has been funding, right? We can't do this without funding, and we've already heard from people who are doing these sorts of things for free, which is not what we want. And so does anyone want to respond to this question out loud? Any of our speakers? If not, that's okay. I can look at the sticky notes here.
Kristen, I can make a quick comment about that. I think something that's really important is for funding agencies to find it important for us to spend money on relationship building. And some of these things that may not be, quantifiable in some way. I can't tell you, the number of students reached or whatever, but just the act of building that relationship is so important for the foundation. And I hope, I dream of a day that our funding agencies will see that as something that's worthwhile.
Yeah, that's a really good point, is if you want to create a program or a partnership or something like that, you can't do it in 1 year with like, oh, here's the tangible outcome. You need the building years and the
Exactly. And it's a very, it's a very westernized way of doing something to just cold email someone, have an ask. That's your relationship and that's it. And that's fine. But in many other cultures, that would be very extractive and, it wouldn't be very culturally sensitive to them.
Thank you. Any other comments from anyone who wants to say anything verbally?
I have one quick comment, real quick, then. It's these resources will constantly need to be changed. It's not a black and white cut dry. Here's a poster. Have fun for educators. We need to be fluid in our resources because the communities themselves are fluid and those needs of the communities are also fluid. And so I agree, funding would be fantastic because it's going to be ever changing and we need to keep up.
Yeah, that's a good point. If things can feel out of touch, even just if they're a few years old, and so needing to constantly be adapting to the communities that we're partnering with and serving is important. Any other comments?
Yeah, I'd like to make a comment. This is Edith Weeks, and I've really enjoyed these presentations today, by the way. Questions such as why is it that there is no electricity or internet or little to no resources on the Native American reservations? Or questions, another question that needs to be asked and understood is why is who determined that certain diverse groups, the last presenter mentioned specifically Blacks and Latinx groups, who determine that these people are not included and that they're not being represented proportionally is a problem. Until we're willing to understand the root cause of these issues that are being discussed, I can't expect to see change. I'm 60 years old now. I've been watching this and studying space for 30 years. I was one of the first people advocating for diversity in outer space activities. And to see so many young people still in that same mode of advocating and preaching. And then funding is there, by the way, at least in the United States, funding is there. So I just wanted to make those comments.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Weeks, and we definitely look forward to your talk tomorrow. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I guess I part of the early career group that's trying to preach and strive to accomplish things, and I definitely welcome your wisdom,
All
which
right,
I think
thank you.
you. I hear your frustration because I feel the same way. I mean, I haven't been at it, quite as long, but it's been a couple decades that I've been on it, and I haven't seen much change either. And I think a lot of it comes down to institutional barriers we're still facing. We're trying to do so much at this grassroots level, but then we always hit up against the institutional barriers, the institutional bias, the institutional, racism sometimes. And I think that's where we lose people is once we're getting them into those institutions, as much as we try it at this level.
Well, what I'm going to do, my presentation is tomorrow. I'm going to answer those questions for everybody because watching the presentations helped me to understand, like, what can I do? And there's good news. We don't have to be stuck here. In addition to institutional bias, you have ideological prompts, you have people categorized into socially constructed racial and ethnic groups, and all that that means in terms of the third party voices, narratives, rhetorical troops, and all these things can be deconstructed and directly aimed at and spoken to. And I believe that this is the key and it's totally possible. And I think if anybody can do it, it won't be me because I'm worn out like the Olympic. In the Olympics, the runner, he passes the baton because he's worn out. That's where I am now. But I will pass the baton to you guys tomorrow.
Thanks for that. We've got 2 minutes left of the day. I see Richard raising his hand. Do you want the last comment right here?
Yes. First of all, Edith, I follow you tomorrow. I'm looking forward to hearing your presentation. But this, issue of how long these questions have been there, it's been there a long time. It's deeply rooted in our culture. And there are so many aspects right now in so many other areas, like with the discussion of how to teach race theory in the schools right now. It's fundamental to understanding what we're doing here. But the big question from a cultural perspective, I think, in terms of the science community who's dealing with lunar and planetary investigation, is to consider with what attitude are we going out into space, and what attitudes do we bring with us, both that we're aware of and those things under the surface. And that discussion needs to bring out all these underlying assumptions so we don't perpetuate the patterns that we're all discussing here. You know, because each of us have done individual efforts that have moved people's lives and brought people down through that braided river in so many good ways. I don't think we should be despairing of the fact that these things go from generation to generation and kind of get reinvented. I'm thrilled to be able to, you know, jump back into that river at this point in my career, because seeing all these young energies is just wonderful.
Yeah, that's the truth. I agree with you. And I don't mean to seem disparaging. I just, I like to agitate people and prime them to want to understand things, you know, the irritation. Someone used the phrase earlier, they said B-I-T-C-H word, and I thought that was so poetic, you know. But that's what I'm trying to do. I'm just trying to prime them because they're so excellent and so caring. And these discussions, first of all, everyone is so young now. That's blowing my mind, because it shows me I've gone through this over the ages. I remember when it was just old white men and me, right? And so now I see this shift with my own eyeballs. And I think it's all good. The fact that people care about this sort of thing is wonderful. So I'm excited. I don't mean to seem disparaging. But there's a lot that they haven't lived through, and so they don't realize why some of these things have been put into motion, and this can be explained. So I'm going to create my presentation to try and lend that insight without getting anyone dirty, hopefully.
Yeah, I Edith, I noticed in your chats that desire to pique everybody's curiosity and get people thinking. That's really wonderful. And I wasn't referring to your comments as despairing. I was thinking in general, there's, you know, we hear that we're having the same conversation now that we did. Yes, but many, many people have benefited from the kind of efforts that are going on. And we can't forget that in the discourse. The funding and all that stuff.
That's right.
Well, yes. Thank you so much for this conversation. I think we need to be agitated, and I definitely appreciate all of the prompts from those of you who have thought about this for a long time. I'm really looking forward to tomorrow. And so with that, I know we're over time, so I'm going to thank the speakers, thank everyone for the participation. If you need to head out, definitely go ahead. Parvati and I are going to spend a minute or two talking, like reflecting on the day, if anyone wants to stick around and chat about that with us. But otherwise, thank you so much for the speakers and everyone who participated today. It's been a great day so far.
And thank you.
Thank you. See you tomorrow.
All right. See you guys tomorrow.
Parvati, do you want to lead a discussion on reflections?
I think it might just be a few of us, but yeah.
Just a minute.
Yeah, no, I think I think that last exchange between Dr. Shope and Dr. Weeks really captured something I've been thinking, but kind of struggling to put into words. Like, I feel like, you know, today you know, on the one hand, I feel really energized. Like there's so many tangible, concrete ideas and things that people have been working on. But on the other hand, you know, I was thinking there's also some, it feels like there's something deeper in the culture and the why of what, of, you know, why we're here and why we're doing this that we haven't quite touched on yet. And so I think that really does set us up well for tomorrow, where hopefully, you know, we'll get a little bit more into sort of looking at what we're doing and why we're doing it and how we can do it better. But yeah, and I love that last exchange between Dr. Sherp and Dr. Weeks, and I'm looking forward to interacting more with everyone tomorrow. What about you?
Well, thank you for inviting baby boomers into your mix.
We want everyone here.
You know, we were the best generation there ever was.
I'm not going to argue
Just
with
kidding.
That. I'm not taking that bait.
All right.
Yeah. Thanks.
All right. I'll see
yeah.
you guys tomorrow.
Bye.
All right. Thank you.
See ya.
Yeah.
Bye.
Yeah. I think that was
All right,
great.
See you.
And I think we can wrap up and keep brainstorming how to convince people to spend money on this. That was my main takeaway, I think. Everyone, this is really, really worth doing, and it all needs money. So if anyone else wants to put their reflection of what they took away from today, feel free to do that on the mural board in the reflection section. Otherwise, we will talk to you tomorrow. Anything else, Parvati?
No, I think that's it. So mural boards are still open. Ricky, the chat has been really active and really great. So if you could save that and share that with Kristen and I, that would be great, so we don't lose everything.
Yeah, I'll care
thanks,
for
everyone.
That and send that off to you a little bit later.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. Yep, no hurry, and applause for Ricky for doing his thing all this time. And thank you, everyone, for participating and sharing slides and moderating and documenting. And we will reconvene tomorrow at the same time. Would anyone, we can, so feel free to head off. So think of this as, you know, the seminar is over. Most people have headed out of the meeting room. There's a few folks still sticking around. We don't have leftover cookies. But if anyone, you know, if anyone would, I'd like to, we're down to a smaller crowd. If anyone would like to unmute and share any reflections, you know, we'd love to hear from you. But
Parvati,
of course,
this
yeah.
is Lillian Ostrak. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
We hear you great,
I just
Lillian.
Wanted to say as a comment overall, and I really appreciated you acknowledging that there was like a lot going on during the sessions, because you've got the slides and the Miro boards, which are fantastic, I think, and as well as the chat. I was trying to see if there were many people asking questions in the Q&A box, and it doesn't seem so. And so just maybe tomorrow, I think almost everybody just went ahead and put things in the chat, but maybe focusing on, okay, don't bother with the Q&A box, since it wasn't really used. And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, anybody who's still here, but I think that kind of having that active engagement through both the presentations and the discussion periods was really helpful, as opposed to flipping back and forth between chat and Q&A and Miro board.
Yeah, I guess the Q&A, I'm trying to decide, because as a session chair, like, I could not follow the chat. And so if someone really wants their question to be asked, like, I want the Q&A
okay.
to be an option. And so,
okay, so
happy for people to ignore it, but like, if someone really wants to utilize it, I kind of want them to be able to utilize it.
Okay. I wasn't aware that, I know that most of the moderators and the speakers did say that they couldn't see the chat when they were presenting and stuff. I didn't realize that with the Q&A, it would maybe pop up for you. So that's
yeah,
the next
it's a separate
season.
Box.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
And the Q&A is only visible to the hosts and co-hosts when somebody asks a question. So it doesn't go out to everybody until a host or co-host answers it within the box, and then it is published.
Okay.
So you may not have seen all the questions that came in through the Q&A, but we did.
Okay. That's really helpful, because I've been in meetings before with something similar, like a big webinar, hundreds and hundreds of people, and I didn't realize that the Q&A here was working that same way. So thanks for explaining that.
And then
yeah,
I couldn't
yeah,
figure
thanks,
out how
Megan.
to I couldn't figure out for the life of me how to type words on the sticky notes. I could click and drag it, but then whenever I typed letters, no words would ever appear.
That's odd. So, yeah, I wonder if it's just acting weird. I mean, in theory, you know, you drag something and let me see. I'm trying this out live and I see Kristen is as well. So I think you drag and then maybe if you double click the note before typing, that might get it to wake up.
Okay.
But you know, but if not, we'll you know, we can hear you great. So if it doesn't work, so if dragging and double clicking okay. before typing doesn't work, then we're happy to hear your wonderful voice instead.
Yeah, we always know that something's gonna fail, so that's why we like having multiple opportunities.
You could always put your comments into the WebEx chat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
yes.
we'll say.
I know,
we'll
but I wanted
out.
To.
And
I
then that could be added
to
the
you know,
mirror board.
I know. I wanted to be all cutesy and modern like everybody else, and I just maybe in my mind I didn't think I could do it or something, so I messed it up with the ninja Jedi mind trick or something. I don't know, but. And I didn't even notice the Q&A at all until the person just mentioned it 5 minutes ago. Like my mind just blocked it out. I just worked with the chat, but.
Which is totally fine. Maybe we should just not
yeah,
use
but
the
you guys, you guys are excellent. I just thought this was so wonderful that you're doing this and it's so exciting. So I just wanted to say that.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks so much for your comments. It was an engaging conversation this afternoon.
Yeah, thank you. Yes.
All right, should we call it a day?
Yes. All right, goodbye, everybody. I'll see you tomorrow.